Sue, and I mean this, you and Amos have been dear friends for a long time, and I'm glad that we finally had this opportunity to come together.
Me too, and we feel the same.
When Amos and Sue and Gloria and I get together, it's a whole lot of laughing, right?
We have a lot of fun, don't we? No matter what.
You know, we'll talk later as to, you know, when we met and how it all started. But I want to start this program off with one of the songs that you sang at a tabernacle 20 miles down the road from here, one of my favorite shoots that we have ever done. Tell them when you saw me, I was on my way.
Yeah, I remember that song, but I mostly remember how you introduced that song to me. I was in Chattanooga, Tennessee, and you left a message on my phone and said, there's this song, and all I know of it is just tell them when you saw me, I was on my way. And I said, who wrote it? And you said, I don't know. And I said, well, where do I find it? And you said, ask Vestal. And we found it, and it was an amazing thing to find that song, and I still sing it today. But yeah, Mark somehow, I think, tagged me as the camp meeting singer.
Yeah.
Because I think at camp meeting, you do things long and loud and with everything you have. Well, and that's kind of how I learned to sing.
When we first met, were you with the Downings then?
I was.
And you came from Arkansas?
I did. Fresh out of high school, I was entering beauty pageants for the summer and then was told by a friend that Paul and Ann Downing were starting a group. And they said, they're looking for an alto singer.
Had you followed the quartets up until then?
I had. When I was about 9 years old, my brother, who's about 10 years older than I, used to take me on dates with he and his girlfriends to the Robinson Auditorium in
Little Rock,
Arkansas.
We've sung there, yeah.
And he introduced me to Southern Gospel, and I was hooked, absolutely hooked. Woke up every day, every Sunday of my life to Jubilee. And I wanted to be like those people that sang. There wasn't really a lot of places for girls at that time.
Yeah.
And then when the Downing started and I got the job, it was a pretty exciting day for me.
And you were there, what, a couple years?
I was there about 18 months, and then I left and went with the Spear family, which was really the dream of my lifetime.
And in all fairness, there was so much history there with Dad and Mom Spear and then the great songs that Dad Spear wrote.
Mm-hmm.
One of the songs that you were featured on, it started out with Ben, but it finally got to you, was Dad Spear's old convention song, I Never Shall Forget That Day. However, he wrote it pretty strict and pretty straight.
Mm-hmm.
And then somewhere along the way, they kind of got a halftime feel in it and jazzed it up a little bit.
They jazzed it up, and when they brought it to me, and he said, now you take this and take it home, Brock said. And it became kind of my signature song with the Spear family, and it was so exciting. I still sing it to this day.
The first live performance we ever did of a homecoming, we had done several in the studio, but the first setting in front of an audience was at the old Ryman Auditorium. And you wound it up, and Ben kept saying, one more time.
Yeah, I remember one time in Indianapolis at the all-night sundown, sun-up sing.
Yeah.
We sang 17 courses in the key of D of I Never Shall Forget the Day. And it was rocking. That whole stadium was rocking, and it is still a great song. Just, it was so fun.
Were those exciting days with the Spears?
You know what? That was my dream, to sing with the Spear family, and I never ever dreamed that I would have that opportunity. But so much of my life was formed in those times, musically and spiritually, because Ben really made, as much as I hated him for it at the time, he made a rhythm piano player out of me.
Yeah.
And now my musicians at my church will tell you that I'm a stickler for that even now. But it was because he just kept pounding it in my head. And then, you know, I was young and impressionable, and if I ever got hurt or had a tough day, it was Brock who would sit and read scripture to me or just hold me like a father and tell me everything's going to be all right.
Did you know that when Dad and Mom sang with them?
I didn't. They were already in heaven when I when I joined them. I saw them in concert when I was growing up, but I never knew them.
Boy, as a kid, it seems if we had two people in our field who were just pure and motives were as pure, and they seemed as innocent as they could be. They just loved the music. Because even in our field, it's very easy to get a little bit calloused, you know, because you have to do the same songs every night and everything.
Right.
But it was not true with Dad and Mom. I mean, it was something they believed. You knew they believed it, and they loved it, and it just came out.
Well, and the thing that I knew working with them for the years that I did, they really demanded excellence from their own family.
Yeah.
And that carried down through the years with the Spear family, because we didn't do anything by accident.
Nope.
We worked hard at what we did.
And the parts were all written out.
Absolutely.
And you did it exactly like the parts were. Because if you're going to harmonize and blend, mm-hmm. that has to be the case.
That's right. And we all were really pressed to the line in a lot of cases to just do it right. And we wouldn't take it on stage until it was exactly right. And I appreciate that now. At the time, we were kind of aggravated about it. But you really appreciate that over a period of time.
One night in Memphis, I think, was especially special for you because it was awfully close to Arkansas, right?
Very close to home. I had all my family there, and they thought this was the greatest. I think that was the first time that they ever got to see a live taping, and it was pretty fun.
Yeah. And the crowd was exciting, and I mean, right from the very, very beginning. And we did one of the first tunes that we did in Sweet 16 as a homecoming group. And you were part of that group, weren't you?
Yes, I was.
You and Ann Downing and Rex Nealon and Jake Hess.
Brock.
Brock was part of that. Right. I mean, we had all the original cast.
Yeah. Yeah, I still hear those, and I hear voices that I can pick out in each one of them. And it's pretty amazing to remember those days. It's just so fun.
You know, it's one thing to perform and sing all around the country, but my wife's parents were pastors, and I've been in their home. That is quite a transition. I've been in their home at 9, 10, 10, 30, 11 o'clock at night when some of the parishioners were there, and you would want to say, okay, let's put a period on this, go home, we'll go to bed, and we'll talk about this again.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Pastoring is day and night.
It is. I hated it in the early years and didn't know how to handle it. And I actually, after being married to a pastor for 34 years, have come to really love it. It's a wonderful place to be. He tells everybody we've been happily married for 30, and out of 34, that's not bad.
No. Will he just being honest?
Yeah, I think. Yeah, because, I mean, we all...
Because probably in any good marriage, you're probably about 10% of the time, that it could have been a little bit better.
Yeah, but those bad times make you better in the good
times.
You're
exactly right.
Because we work through things and we learn how to appreciate each other a little bit more. But God didn't just smile on me when he gave me Amos Dodge. He laughed. He said, this girl needs help and I'm going to give her some. So when I met him, I was with the Spear family and he proposed to me 5 minutes after we met.
Oh, brother.
He said, I knew what I wanted, and I saw the woman I wanted to spend the rest of my life with. And Brock kept saying, it's that preacher. He's got your heart. And I said, no. And he said, look, I've seen him come and go, and this one's got your heart. And then he leaned over and said, and if he doesn't, you're crazy.
Well, you know, here again, it's good to have some older people like Brock in your life mm-hmm. who have good judgment. Mm-hmm. Fixed marriages are not totally bad.
That's right. That's right.
You get some old. In fact, I kind of like the fact that my kids came to me and said, would this be a good one?
Yeah.
But to have somebody like Brock Spear say.
Well, I remember him saying to me one time, I hate, like everything, to lose you because mm-hmm. you've been a great person in our group. He said, but I have a wonderful marriage and I would never deny you the joy of that. And he said, I want you to have that, and I believe you'll have that with Amos Dodge. And he was right. But honestly, having a pastor as a husband and being the pastor's wife and sometimes finishing a Gaither concert at 1 in the morning and jumping on a plane at 5 the next morning to be home and on the piano stool at 10 in the morning, sometimes those are the things that have kept me grounded.
The beautiful thing about when we ask you to come do dates with us, like across to Israel, you bring Amos with you, and it brings a whole lot more meaning to it because he can add all his biblical training to what we did. And was Israel a special place?
You know what? I will never be the same, and I know that's cliche sounding, but to sing the songs that we sang in the homeland.
Yeah.
Of the Bible. And I'm telling you, everything came alive and we left there changed. I will never forget the moments that weren't supposed to happen.
Yeah.
The ones afterwards when we were standing around the piano and we were all weeping and crying and worshiping because God had done something in our hearts that night.
Yeah.
And thanks for that opportunity because that was a chance of a lifetime and an experience that no one who was there would ever forget. My father was a very simple man, 7th grade education, but one of the wisest, most precious, loving men in the whole world. And he just modeled for the 3 children what Christ-like would be.
Yeah.
And I'm very blessed to have had a father like that.
And he was very proud of you, wasn't he?
Oh, yeah. In the days when I was with the Spears and early Downings, he used to go into Kmart or Walmart and whoever carried records at the time, and he would thumb through all of the records and find everyone that had my picture on it and put it on the front. He did. And every time, if anybody would walk by, he'd say, y'all ever heard of the Spear family? Well, that's my girl, and she sings with them. And then when the Gaither thing started, she said, my daughter, she sings with Bill Gaither. She does. That's my baby. He was so proud of his children and lived a great life, and it was a great example to us all.
Tell me of the time you were singing somewhere in a church.
I had just finished, well, this was in the last year of my father's life, and he was 84 when he passed away, and he just had some strokes and was in a wheelchair by this time. And I said, I want him to come to the concert. And my brother said, well, he gets a little bit agitated and uneasy. And I said, well, I don't care. I don't know how much more time I have for him to come. And he loves to hear his baby sing. So this particular night, we were in Little Rock, Arkansas, doing this conference, and probably 2,300 people. And they brought my dad in, rolled him in, set him kind of close to the wall. And I had just finished singing Amazing Grace a cappella. And I mean, it was, you could hear a pin drop in the place. And I didn't know this story until the day after my father passed away. And we were comforting ourselves telling stories about my dad, who was a really funny guy. Very simple man. Looked like, act like, talk like Junior Samples on Hee Haw. Most of the time, his teeth were in his pocket and chew tobacco in his jaw. Just a great, I mean, you met him. He's just an awesome guy. And so anyway, my brother said, well, remember what Dad did the last time he heard you sing? And I said, no. He said, well, you had just finished Amazing Grace and everything was quiet. And all of a sudden, he leaned over me and he poked me in the side. He said, boy, how much you reckon they're paying her tonight? And everybody in there could hear it. I knew something was going on, but didn't remember to ask and didn't know that. And we talked about that later, and I related that story to my husband, and he said, but you have to remember your dad's point of reference was that he loved you so much that he figured whatever they were paying you wasn't nearly enough.
Was not nearly enough.
Yeah, because he loved his girl. He thought nobody ever accomplished anything quite like having me, and that's probably the truth. He's a great man.
How does it feel to be a grandma?
I love it. I'll tell anybody I have two of the most beautiful, wonderful, smart little grandkids in the whole world.
Yeah. It's kind of like a second chance, isn't it?
It is. My husband said, everybody says that theirs are the smartest and brightest and cutest. And he said, but I've got a problem. What do you do when yours really are? But we've been so blessed. Our daughter and our son-in-law work with us in our ministry there. Our son-in-law is our church administrator, and our daughter is our worship leader. And, you know, it's just amazing to see what your children become. And then these little grandkids come along. You watch your daughter be a parent and watch how they're raising them up and training them. And it's pretty awesome. And then when they walk in the house and go, Nana, it's like, okay, what do you want? A house, a car, what can I give you? There's nothing. It's a different love than your own children, isn't it? Don't you think?
Yeah, it really is.
And you always say, we can spoil them and send them home. But it's more than that. Amos and I have realized that our life counts now as much as it did with our own child.
Yeah.
Because they're watching us. Our youngest one, Madeline, said the other day, Mommy, Papa works and teaches in the big room, doesn't he? And she said, yeah. And she said, yeah. She's been telling us all that she's afraid of the darks.
Yeah.
And she said, yeah, Papa teaches in the big room, and he helps people not be afraid of the darks.
Ah, that's good.
And I thought, yeah, you get it, you know, but the impact you even have on your grandkids is just amazing to us. But there's nothing like those little grandbabies, and Sydney will lay in the bed at night and put my face in her hands, and she knows she's not supposed to talk in the middle of the night because she'll be up all night if she does. And she'll say, Nana, you're just the best Nana ever. And I just want to get up and say, hey, you want to go to McDonald's in the middle of the night, whatever you want to do. But it's a great joy to have grandkids. And it's a great joy to have godly kids, too.
Yeah.
And that's a great reward. And probably if I had to tell you what was my greatest accomplishment, my daughter.
We've been so blessed in this field with some wonderful writers of some great songs. You know, Gloria and I obviously love the songs that we have written, but I genuinely love other great songs from great writers. If it's a good song, I don't care where it came from, I still say one of the greatest praise songs ever written was Schubert's Holy is the Lord. So it doesn't have to be written in our time. Could have been written 200 or 300 years ago. But a great song is a great song. Mm-hmm. And Bud Chambers wrote a wonderful song about what we were destined to be from the beginning.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you gave me the opportunity to sing that in South Africa. And my husband said, I couldn't help but weep when you sang that because I knew that that really talked about your life and that was what you were destined to do. You were destined to serve the Lord and sing His praises. And he said, I just couldn't stop it. Mm-hmm. And when I sing that in concert, it's amazing how people just will weep because they said, God has used this in my life to let me know that what I'm doing is right, that I'm on a right track.
Yeah. My little sister used to sing in our trio, the Gaither trio, and my brother passed away with cancer. And my sister has been battling leukemia for the last 4 or 5 years. She is cancer-free now, and we're very happy for that. But she used to sing this, and I loved the second verse. My hands were made, simple little song, my hands were made to help my neighbor. My eyes were made to read God's word.
My feet were made to walk in His footsteps.
My feet were made to walk in His footsteps. My body is the temple of the Lord's. And when you understand that concept about why we were created to do what we do.
Mm-hmm. We get it all wrong sometimes, don't we?
Yeah. Especially singing this in Africa, when you think about world hunger and world problems, I mean, God only has our hands.
If we can give Him our hands and give Him our heart, then we're giving.
Yeah.
We get, you know, we've talked about giving being so much more than
money.
But it's more about giving of ourselves and giving of the talents that God has given us. Mm. What a privilege it is to do that, to give Him what we have. It may be little, but what we have.
I will never forget the day that Ben Spear called me, and that was a big deal for me. I was just a school teacher up in Alexandria, and he said, Bill, I would like to look at publishing some of your songs. I went, Ben Spear was publishing one of my songs. Because he was one of the few publishers in the business. And, well, what are you talking about? He said, I've been to Calvary, the joy of serving the Lord, and I had done an arrangement of the old-fashioned meeting and added some new material to it. It was written by a guy named Buffin, the original part. But it was done in the evangelical circles up north, pretty straight. Was an old-fashioned meeting in an old-fashioned place, da-da-da. I thought, boy, you could pep that up a little bit and put some extra parts to it, some counterparts, have a pretty good song. So I had this, and I gave it to the Spears, and they recorded it probably with Ginger.
With Ginger,
yeah,
it was.
Yeah. One of the early records. But then later on the Gospel Singing Jubilee, when you joined them,
They brought that song to me and said, we've not had a girl that could fire this up since Ginger. Let's try this.
Yeah.
And boy, it took off.
Yeah.
And the combination of the back and forth between Ben and I was pretty electric. And and still when we sing it, we've done it a few times out there with you, and it works every time.
In 92, 93, one of the early tapings, like maybe a Landmark or something like that, and I felt so bad. We'd worked them so hard, and it was 5 o'clock. And we said, if we let you go and go eat some food, would you mind putting on some Christmas clothes? We'll bring in a Christmas tree. Turn on some Christmas lights. And let's do a Christmas program while we're here. And it was really spontaneous. It was like a spontaneous Christmas program. This wasn't arranged or anything. And who was playing?
Anthony.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'll never forget that day because it was a long day, and I was having a little bit of a struggle with my asthma that day. And I thought about not coming back, but I said, no, I've committed, and I'm coming back. And got my red jacket on, and I came back, and we started singing.
Yeah.
And somebody said, let's sing Oh Holy Night, because those were the days where everything was really not planned and spontaneous. It was really fun.
Yeah.
And they said, let's do a Holy Mass. So they did the first verse in the key of C. And I leaned over to Gloria and said, sing the second verse. That's the best one. Yeah. She said, we don't know it. You sing it. And handed me the microphone, and I sang it. And I mean, sometimes, you know, when you sing, you know that you're in the groove. You're right where you need to be. And that was one of those days for me where when I started singing that, it was just like I gave my own self chills, and I knew it wasn't about me. But it was the truly he taught us to love one another. His law is love and his gospel is peace. And I can't tell you the comments that I get from people to this day about that moment.
This next song has been around for a long time, when he was on the cross. Mm-hmm. I never heard it much when the Florida Boys sang it. I first heard the song with the Brooklyn Tabernacle Choir. And I had to pull off the side of the road, because when I got to the chorus of, he knew me, yet he loved me, because I just knew that if he really knew me, he would love me. Yeah.
True for all of us.
And don't most of us feel that way about anybody, you know?
Yeah.
That blew my mind.
Yeah.
And when we went to, where was it, Ireland? Or?
It was Ireland.
And asked you to sing that. And that's become a wonderful song for you, hasn't it?
It really has been one of the most powerful tools that I've had in my hands in a lot of years, for a lot of reasons. Number one, everybody relates to the fact that we all feel inadequate and feel like, you know, oh, wow, God loves me even though he knows all of my warts, all of my faults, but that he cared enough to give his best for me. And that's pretty amazing. I always relate it to my father, who, when I said, you know, he thought I was worth everything. And if my earthly father felt that way about me, that he thought I was worth everything, then how much more did my heavenly father care about me, that when he was on the cross, he was thinking of me, what would be best for me? Pretty awesome thought.
We did our taping in Lebanon, Tennessee, right outside of Nashville, the campfire. You said, I'll come, Bill, but I can't sing. Pretty scary when a singer can't sing.
Probably the most scary time of my life.
You were so kind, though, at the campfire. You smiled through the whole thing, and you at least sang in the lower range, and then kind of lips sank the rest of it.
It was everything I could do to keep from just trying to blast through and sing, and I knew that if I did, that I'd do permanent damage. But I came there, and, you know, people didn't understand that. I didn't say that to anybody, but I came there with a drain tube and stitches in my side, because you had always asked me to come to these things. And when you did, I never wanted to say no, because I never wanted to not be a part of it. So my husband said, it'll be good. Why don't you just go? We'll take care of you however we have to. And I came, and I'm not sorry I did. I paid a little price because of a lot of issues that I was going through health-wise, but I was really glad I came. And just to be in that atmosphere, singing with those people, even if it was just lip-syncing, was real therapeutic for me.